So, it happened once in the following hadith, hadith number 1770. It's a sound hadith and agreed upon its authenticity. Aisha Ummu Mu'mineen radiyallahu anha. And the hadith, by the way, is narrated by many other companions. But here the current narration is narrated by Ummu Mu'mineen Aisha radiyallahu anha. أن قريشا أهمهم شأن المرأة المخزومية التي سرقت فقالوا من يكلم فيها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالوا ومن يجترئ عليه إلا أسامة بن زيد حب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فكلمه أسامة فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أتشفع في حد من حدود الله تعالى ثم قام فاختطبا ثم قال إنما أهلك الذين قبلكم أنهم كانوا إذا سرق فيهم الشريف تركوا وإذا سرق فيهم الضعيف أقاموا عليه الحد وأيم الله لو أن فاطمة بنت محمد سرقت لقطعت يدها متفق عليه. In another narration, فتلون وجه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال أتشفع في حد من حدود الله فقال أسامة استغفر لي يا رسول الله قال ثم أمر بتلك المرأة فقطعت يدها. So here Umm al-Mu'mineen, the mother of the believers, Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, narrated that once Quraysh were very anxious and worried about a woman from Bani Makhzum. This woman have committed theft. So Quraysh were wondering if anyone can talk to the Prophet ﷺ about this woman because she's from a very prestigious family and from Bani Makhzum. And it will be a shame for the whole family and defaming them. So they said, and who be better than Usama? Who's Usama? Usama ibn Zayd is the most beloved to the Prophet, and his father was his most beloved as well. As you all know that he had adopted Usama's father, Zayd ibn Haritha, and they used to call him Zayd ibn Muhammad, and they called him Hibbu Rasulillah. He is like, you know, the man whom the Prophet loves most. And his son has become Hibbu Rasulillah wabnu Hibbi Rasulillah. He has become like his father, most beloved to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Said, finally found him. That's Usama. He is the best person to speak to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He loves him so much. He may convince him to waive the punishment. What was the punishment? Cutting her hand off from the wrist, the right hand. Why? Because you've committed theft. And it was something valuable. So Usama radiallahu anhu doesn't know that it is haram to intercede concerning the hudud, the punishment which is set by Allah. So he went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Rasulallah, about this woman from Bani Makhzum, as you know, her family, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't let him finish. And he was very angry with Usama, whom he loves most. And said, أَتَشْفَعُ فِي حَدٍ مِّنْ حُدُودِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. How dare you intercede regarding one of the punishment prescribed by Allah, O Usama. Usama started panicking. The Prophet ﷺ didn't satisfy with that. Rather, he got up and he started delivering a speech, a sermon. And he said in it, indeed, what destroyed the people before you, referring to Bani Israel, was just that whenever a person of a high rank among them committed theft, they spared them. Oh, he's so-and-so, and his uncle, and his dad, and his grandfather, and his in-laws. But if the same crime was committed by an ordinary person, they definitely inflicted the prescribed punishment on him. Yani they threw the book at him. Then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I swear by Allah that if even Fatima the daughter of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم should steal, I would have had her hand cut off. يعني النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم did not exclude anyone for any status. Whoever is involved in a crime that incurs the punishment which is set by Allah, once the case is presented before the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, that's it. There is only one case which, if the person went willingly and he admitted, like in the case of Ma'iz, no one have seen him. So he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he admitted, he confessed his sin. And the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is trying to ward him off and says, "Ya Ma'iz, maybe you just kissed, maybe you just hugged, maybe you just cuddled." And every time he says, "No, I've done zina." So when he comes to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from his right side, he turns away from him and he looks the opposite direction. So Ma'iz turns around and he faces him and said, "Ya Rasulullah, purify me because I've committed adultery." Back and forth until he testified and he confessed his sin four times. Why four times? Equivalent to the four witnesses. At that, the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Okay, punish him." When he was being punished, he ran off, but they chased him and they finished him. So the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "You should have let him. Because if a person have confessed the sin himself and didn't bear the punishment and he changed his view, then you should let him go." Okay? And if there is any doubt, like, "Oh my God, I didn't know, wallahi, I thought it's my aba'ah. Subhanallah, his purse is like my purse exactly. I took it home and I have no clue." And also look at the history of the person. Allah the Almighty doesn't expose somebody who's doing this for the first time. No way. Doesn't expose a beginner. Nor does he expose a person who's doing this because he was in dire need to eat or for treatment. He exposes a person who's used to this perpetration and this evil act. Khalas, he gave him chances after chances. Now it's time to be cut and to be purified. Let's sort it out this way. Not just punished, but rather to be purified. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbade Usama, and he was angry with him to the extent Usama later on said, "Ya Rasulullah, seek forgiveness for my sin of trying to intercede for a sinner." And the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered this woman to be punished. And when the punishment was carried out, she lost her right wrist, her hand. Later on, she repented, and she repented sincerely, and she was a righteous woman, and she got married from one of the Sahaba. And she used to visit Aisha radiyallahu anha and would ask her questions to present them to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she would do so on her behalf and then deliver the answer of the Messenger of Allah to her. Oh, so after committing the sin and receiving the punishment, go ahead and resume your life as regular. And the entire ummah should treat you as a regular and a normal person because you receive the adequate punishment, except the sin of Al-Qadhf. الَّذِينَ يَرْمُونَ الْمُحْصَنَاتِ ثُمَّ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَأْتُوا بِأَرْبَعَةِ شُهَدَاءَ فَاجْلِدُوهُمْ ثَمَانِينَ جَلْدَةً. So flog them 80 lashes. وَلَا تَقْبَلُوا لَهُمْ شَهَادَةً أَبَدًا. And never accept their testimony. وَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. So later on, even after they are punished, we don't seek their shahada, even in a wedding contract. Because they proven not to be reliable, not to be credible, rather because they delivered a false testimony and they falsely accused a chaste men or women with an evil act of adultery. Somebody would say, why did the Prophet ﷺ bring the name of Fatima, his daughter? Fatima radiallahu anha was the Prophet's most beloved, and she was his sweetheart, the closest to his heart. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned about her merits many a hadith. Fatima, the mother of Al-Hasan wal-Husayn, he said, "She's a piece of me and I'm a piece of her." Radiallahu anha. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "By Allah, even if the person who committed theft happened to be Fatima bint Muhammad, not Fatima bint Makhzum." Fatima bint Makhzum, that was the name of the woman who committed theft. So her name was Fatima as well. He said, guess what? Not only if she's Fatima bint Makhzum, which is an honorable family and a noble tribe. Wallahi, even if she's Fatima, the daughter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad would have been the first to carry out the punishment. Also, I'd like to bring to your attention that the Prophet ﷺ used not to carry out the punishment by himself, but he used to send people to execute the punishment of Allah. And now we know why is it called Had. Stop it right there. Because if you cross this Had, you will be punished. You will deserve this severe punishment. And when the law was practiced and applied, so there was a law and order, the community was pure. Very rare cases of theft. But when the law is lenient and you can get out and get away and maneuver, if you have a good lawyer, even in a country like the States, in New York, going back to my house from work, if it is 8, 9 p.m., you gotta be very extra cautious. Don't carry wallets, laptops, earphones, or valuable stuff, because right away one of these kids will stick you up with a knife, with a gun, with a 9mm, with a shotgun, and say, give me what you have. Can you imagine that? You gotta keep in your pocket about 20 bucks, spare 20 bucks all the time, in case that if somebody sticks you up and says, give me what you have, you have to give him something, or he might get angry at you and shoot you to death. For 20 bucks, even for less. So why this is happening with all the surveillance cameras and this is in America? It is happening because such people know that they can get away with their crimes and they can spend some time in jail and will come back and to resume. But Allah the Almighty says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, والسارق والسارقة فاقطعوا أيديهما جزاء بما كسبا نكالا من الله والله عزيز حكيم. So this is a set punishment by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, when this punishment is really applied, a lot of high ranking officers would lose their hands. A lot of emirs and princes, leaders and governors are more deserving than anyone else to cut off their hands and even their necks. When the law and order of the theft punishment is right, the wealth of the ummah will belong to the ummah. People would really prosper. There would be a state of security. Now, they kidnap girls, women, children, in order to take a ransom, or they kill the child, or they rape the woman. Why is this happening? Because the law is very lenient, and it is not really practiced properly. And there are fake lawyers, and there are dishonest lawyers and dishonest judges. You bribe them, you get away with your crime. So when the law and order is set straight and it is practiced as the time of the Prophet and the companions, then the cases will be just a handful of cases. You know, some people are like that and they repent and they came by themselves admitting their sins and asking Allah for forgiveness and seeking purification. The punishment is severe. Safwan ibn Umayyah, when he was finished performing tawaf, he had a burda, an outer garment. It was worth 30 dirham. 30 dirham is the price of 1 gram of gold. It's like $50. Yeah? $55, $60, 1 gram of gold. He was lying down and he kept his outer garment, he made it like a pillow, and somebody picked it up. So he was caught. So Safwan ibn Umayyah was still new to Islam. He brought him to the Prophet ﷺ. He said, this guy stole my burda when I was asleep. So he asked him, did you steal his burda? He admitted. He said, yes, I did. So he ordered to be taken and to be punished. When Safwan ibn Umayyah learned the punishment would be cutting off his hand from the rest, his right hand, he said, oh, no, I didn't mean that. I don't want his hand to be cut off because of a burda or aba'a, a clock. It's a gift, take it. He said, you should have done that before the case is brought to me. Once the case is brought to the court, then even the plaintiff doesn't have the right to pardon. Because there is a part of it which is haqqullah, the right of Allah, which he has forbidden theft and forbidden stealing. So even if you pardon, you want to pardon, it should be done before the case is presented before the court. You made a deal with the thief and you said, okay, you return everything and I will pardon you. No problem. You can do that. An intercession also before the case is brought to court, it's okay. Once the case is presented before the court or with the emir or with the judge or with the ruler, no one has the right to intercede. No connections whatsoever. This has become purely the haqq and the right of Allah the Almighty.